back into the fight. The swastika, symbol of the Third Reich, and the sinister emblem that would strike terror into the hearts of millions. Since 1945, historians have been preoccupied with explaining the dramatic rise to power of the Nazi Party and of its leader Adolf Hitler, the causes of the Second World War, and the course of events which led to the final destruction of Nazi Germany. So many were the questions to be answered that only recently have researchers begun to investigate the origins of the strange beliefs which lay behind the most evil movement in history. Beliefs which will forever be associated with the swastika. Where did the hooked cross, the swastika, actually come from? Was it really a Buddhist symbol of good luck, reversed in a sinister gesture by Adolf Hitler himself? Did the SS really send teams of archaeologists on expeditions in search of ancient swastikas? Is it true that the Nazi Party was founded by an occultist secret society called Thule, whose swastika emblem it adopted? In the late 1800s, many Westerners, disillusioned by the modern industrial world, looked to the hidden kingdom of Tibet as a source of ancient mystical wisdom. In 1875, a Russian adventuress and self-proclaimed clairvoyant, Madame Helena Petrovna Blavatsky, founded the Theosophical Society, whose teachings were based on experiences she claimed to have had in an underground monastery in the Himalayas. In 1888, Blavatsky published a book, The Secret Doctrine, which purported to show how the universe had passed through seven cycles or rounds, each cycle associated with seven races. She identified the present time as the fourth cosmic round, a period which would be dominated by the fifth root race, a race of supermen she called the Aryans. Up to now, the term Aryan had been used to mean a group of languages originating in India, never a race or a people. The idea of an Aryan race was a fantasy, but thanks to Madame Blavatsky, belief in the existence of the Aryans would gradually take root amongst spiritualists and mystics the world over. Madame Blavatsky was uniquely responsible for one other innovation. She claimed that amongst all the mystical signs and symbols revealed to her, one was the special emblem of the Aryans. That sign was the swastika. For centuries, the swastika had appeared in the Buddhist world as a symbol of good fortune. In Tibet, the swastika was the sign of Agni, the god of fire and creation. The swastika was also to be found in the ancient cultures of South America, West Africa, the Mediterranean, and Northern Europe. Scholars believe that in all these cultures, the swastika represented the swirling rays of the sun. Madame Blavatsky's theosophical teachings soon spread throughout the United States of America and on into Europe. She was particularly popular in Germany and Austria. And there, the swastika, the emblem she had chosen for her theosophical society, became widely known. In the years leading up to the First World War, German-speaking Austrians were an ethnic minority, many of whom longed to be united with Germany. Societies were founded devoted to German culture and history, and one man quickly became the spiritual leader of the Austrian-German cause. Guido von Liszt was an enormously popular occultist writer who claimed psychic visions of the distant past. He made a special study of the runes, an ancient system of writing used by the Vikings and other Nordic peoples. Liszt believed that the runes were magical symbols, and influenced by Madame Blavatsky, he chose the swastika, to the Vikings the rune of the god Thor, as the most potent symbol. Following Blavatsky, he claimed that the swastika was the sign of the Aryans, and he argued the purest descendants of the ancient Aryans were the Germans. By the outbreak of the First World War in 1914, Guido von Liszt had tens of thousands of followers. Societies had been formed to propagate his teachings and to plan for the German Empire that Liszt was by now foretelling. In the German and Austrian trenches, Liszt's works were read eagerly. The swastika, the symbol that Liszt had adopted as the sign of the Aryans, had become hugely popular. And swastika talismans designed by Liszt's followers were sold to the troops. Already the swastika, as the new symbol of militant German nationalism, was being painted unofficially on the sides of German aircraft. To millions of Germans, defeat in 1918 came as a shattering blow. They'd been promised an empire and had instead been humiliated. In the last year of the war, there'd been some dramatic German successes, albeit short-lived. And it seemed to many that there was only one explanation for defeat. Germany had been betrayed from within. Senior army officers, to hide their own failures, quickly cast about for an alibi. They placed the blame squarely on the shoulders of Democrats, communists, and Jews. The abdication of the Emperor Kaiser Wilhelm was the final blow. Overnight, the old Germany had virtually disappeared. A once proud nation had been reduced to a bankrupt and defenseless beggary, presided over by squabbling politicians. Worst of all, Germany, with millions of trained and embittered war veterans on the streets, was quickly descending into anarchy and civil war. Throughout 1918 and 1919, the infant Weimar Republic was rocked by clashes between communists and right-wingers. There were attempted coups in Berlin, in the Ruhr, and in Bavaria. Amongst the right-wing factions, the dreams of an Aryan empire propagated by Guido von Liszt had not been forgotten. The Free Corps, bands of armed veterans organized to fight the communist and defend Germany's borders, adopted as their symbol the swastika. Guido von Liszt's mystical doctrines of Aryan supremacy had by now given rise to a nationwide secret society calling itself the German Order. Its membership was made up of aristocrats, businessmen, and wealthy professionals. And the order was deeply anti-Semitic and anti-democratic. Its members were bound together by occult rituals inspired by Liszt. The Munich Lodge of the German Order was called the Thule Society, after the mythical northern homeland of the Aryan race. The symbol of the Thule Society was the swastika. While German nationalists were adopting the swastika as the emblem of Aryan supremacy, at the same time, under the influence of Madame Blavatsky's theosophy, fascination with the swastika was growing throughout the Western world. The British author Rudyard Kipling's stories of India appeared decorated with a swastika. In Scotland, the discovery of swastika markings in a Pictish cave inspired the creation of the swastika kilt pin. In the United States, costly earrings and brooches were designed in the form of the swastika. During the Great War, the British War Savings Drive had a swastika as its official emblem. Its administrators were awarded swastika lapel badges in recognition of their services to the nation. While members of British mystical circles and druidic cults displayed swastikas on their ceremonial robes.